is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 12, Changes, Chapters 4, 5, and 6. In these chapters, the building is on fire, and it's kind of Harry's fault. A little. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming down like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, once we're doing it. Nobody's putting up a fight. Welcome to the show, everyone. I am Natasha.
I'm RoShawn.
I mean, I'm not being totally fair. He didn't plant the dynamite.
That's true.
But, you know.
He didn't start the fire.
I am not rising to that bait, ma'am.
Damn it.
I'm not doing it. So, yeah, we pick up with Chapter 4 right where we left off with Harry pursuing these Red Court vampires into his office building.
Yep.
And Harry is, like, really low-key looking for somebody to take his anger on out on right now.
Yeah, he is.
So they, like, really are in the wrong place at the wrong time, in a way.
He was itching to get into that building. Mm-hmm. And when they told him to stay out, he didn't have a leg to stand on, mm-hmm. you know, because of what Susan and Martin are looking for, being bits of data and technology, and Harry being, like, you know, bad news around any of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So as soon as he sees these fucking vampires slithering up the wall, which unpleasant
yes.
visual.
Don't like that at all.
He was ready to go.
Yeah. Yeah, so he's got his... He doesn't have his veil up anymore because it takes too much energy to keep that going. And it also distorts his own vision. So that's not really... It's not going to offer enough of an advantage to sacrifice what he can see.
Right.
But he does, I think, do something that, like, keeps the sound from traveling.
He does. He does this neat trick that we haven't seen him do before. And I thought it was really funny because they make it a point to tell us that this is, like, low-level magic. It's easy peasy for somebody of Harry's status and abilities.
Right.
But we've never seen him do it before.
That's true.
So,
yeah, that's true. That's a fair point. Mm-hmm.
But whatever the history of this particular spell is and why we've never seen it, it puts, like, a buffer or a sound dampener all around him.
Mm-hmm.
So that they don't really hear him coming.
Right.
And he mentions that it's not, it will... If he gets close enough to a vampire, that's not going to work because they'll be able to smell him or they'll be able to hear his heartbeat. But then he also says if they get that close, they'll probably kill him anyway, so it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, I mean, that's a glass half full.
Right?
Can't decide which way that goes, but, you know, I guess it's helpful. I also like the fact that, like, he's glad he's done that by the time he gets to the top because he's breathing so hard because he's just like, oh, God, oh the God. Stairs.
Yeah, he's like, you know, Harry's in good shape and he works out and he runs, but stairs are a different fucking beast.
Yep.
And at the point, he's like, when did I become aware of my knees? Like, when did that become a fucking thing I have to think about?
I heard that line and I was like, RoShawn is going to appreciate that line.
You know I did.
When had my knees become something I had to worry about?
When you get to that whatever the fuck I am, I don't know, age, weight class, whatever, where your knees just aren't what you fucking remember. You know, they're just new. They're new knees. They're, oh my God, girl.
Uh-oh.
a giant moth just flew in front of my computer. I might have to stop recording.
No.
You know, I can't with them, right?
I cannot. Fucking hate moths so much.
It was huge, and it just fluttered past. It was like having a bird in my house. Oh, God. Oh my God. I am upended.
Oh, no.
Over.
Oh, that's and the worst.
I don't know where it went.
I have that kind of thing happen sometimes in my office because I don't have a screen in my window, but I need to open the window sometimes because it gets really stuffy.
Oh, my God.
And I will forget, and it will stay open when the sun has gone down, so the light in here brings them in. So I've, like, once or twice forgot, come in my office at night, and there's, like, 9 moths in here, and I
Holy
want to
shit.
Die. Yeah, it's terrible. I basically will, like, spray bug spray. Like, we have this, like, you know, intense fucking industrial strength that we used when we had bed bugs for a minute. It worked, by the way. If you all have bed bugs and you need a spray, you get at me and I will point you to the one that worked when our exterminator did not. But I'll spray that shit around, close the door, leave for like half an hour, and then come back. Nary a moth to be found. They are somewhere, but they are not flying, and that is all I care about.
I don't know where this motherfucker came from because I have screens. Oh, the kitchen window.
Uh-oh.
Doesn't have a screen. That's right. Oh, well, guys, if I shriek in the middle of this podcast, you all will know what the fuck happened. That thing would have touched my arm or my head or something. Oh, my God. I wear glasses. You ever have a bug get, like, behind your glasses?
Oh, my God. No. Oh my God, I thought I already had a terrible fear with it being stuck in my hair, but behind my glasses is worse. Why did you even put that in my head? Oh,
it is
why did
the
you
worst
that?
Fucking thing that has ever happened to me, and I've had some terrible shit happen to me.
When did that happen?
It's happened more than once.
Oh.
It used to happen to me a lot when I was a kid, when I was, like, obviously outside for a longer period of time. If I was out, like, playing in summertime and, like a moth or a mosquito or whatever, you know. Or sometimes, like, you know those big swarms of gnats?
Oh,
you
I
see
fucking
sometimes?
Hate that, yeah. You walk right through them before you realize. Worst.
And, like, sometimes you just be out, you know. You're just out talking, drinking, whatever. And it's summertime, and a bug will just, like, fly, like, right for your face, like a fucking kamikaze bug. And it'll just, like, end up, like, behind your glasses, and you're just like, oh, what the fuck? It is the worst.
That's got to be really funny to see, though, because I imagine that you just start smacking yourself in the face.
That is exactly what happened.
Oh, that's kind of funny.
Oh, yeah, it's happened to me more than once. Not too embarrassed. I should be too embarrassed. But, all right. But anyway.
Anyway. What were you talking about? Knees? Oh, you're talking about when I get getting to this age or weight class or whatever it
yes,
is.
Yes, when your knees are just like, fuck you. We're not doing that. Mm-hmm. When it's something that you have been doing like literally all your life, you know?
Do you know what
walking
I
up stairs.
Realized the other day? I was talking to Owen about this and all of a sudden I had a moment of just like, not even panic, just like, oh no. I realized that a lot of us, we spend so much of our lives planning for the future or wanting to regain something from our pasts once we pass age like 25. And a lot of us, it's our bodies. Like missing the way we used to look, trying to get that back via working out or dieting or whatever. And I think that a lot of it is because we were living in the moment as teens and early 20s in a way that we can't really manage to do as adults. Do you know what mm-hmm. I mean? So mm-hmm. we like feel like we are in the wrong body now because that is the body that we are supposed to have. And we ruined ourselves, and now we just have to get our proper body back. And I realized the other day that not only will we never have that body again, you can get in good shape and everything, but that is gone. Youth is
right.
gone.
Yeah. You're not going to just be 20 again because you started working out.
Right. But not only that, every single time that you get used to the body that you have, you've got like a couple years before it starts to really change on you again. And it takes so long to get used to the body that you're already in. It takes us so long to like come to terms, I think, with the fact that, yeah, my knees are a problem, or yeah, my weight is just my weight, and I can't live like I'm always going to be able to fit into these other pants. I don't wear that size anymore.
Right.
But even once you get used to that, all of a sudden you're going to start to sag in a way that you weren't. And so you like, you thought you had been, you had come to terms and that, all right, you know, I know what my body is and I'm accepting it. And then like 3 years later, you're like, what the fuck is this? And that's just what life is going to be.
That's just what
forever now. Forever. Life is just constantly discovering that something else has broken on you.
Yeah, that's really what you have to look forward to for the next ever.
This is horseshit.
Yeah. This is the thing about your body that I think is really impossible to explain when you're younger or to get when you're younger. And it's kind of hard to even grasp for me at my age at 45. Mm-hmm. And that's that your body is simultaneously fully yours and belongs solely to you. And it's yours forever. But it's never the same.
Mm-hmm.
It's never the same thing.
Yep.
You know, it's always yours. It's always your body. But it's always something different.
Yep.
You know? So it's like those two things are existing at the same time.
I think we have like a lot of our memories of like, you know, first sexual experiences or first like really feeling strong when doing a sport or dancing or something like very physical. Those memories are so attached to youth a lot of times because it's the first time that we like experienced that thing. And so we have it in our heads that that's like how our bodies are. And it just takes so long to really understand that you just feel that way because your memories associated with that body are very strong. But that's it. It's memory. That is not how you are supposed to be forever.
Right.
And
it's just how you were at one time.
Yeah. At a really formative moment that like does mean a lot to you and that's valid and everything. But that does not mean that at that point in time you were at peak or that is something that you can ever get back to. Like, oof, man.
That's like my theory of everyone's favorite decade will be whatever decade they were in their 20s. You know, my obsession with the 90s, because I was in my 20s in the 90s, was great. Everything was great.
God, you know?
Yeah.
And that's, I think, part of why, like, people don't listen to new music as they get older.
That was going to be the next thing I said, is music is another one where, I mean, music is a little bit harder to be, like, fast and loose with the rules because people's likes can transcend, you know, decades and genres and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But as a general statement, usually the music that was the music to your life when you were in your 20s is also the music that has, like, the most nostalgia for you, you know? It's connected to the most, like, what you would consider good times or fun or whatever. And that's just because it's your fucking 20s. Mm-hmm. It kicks ass.
Yep.
It kicks ass. If you're in your 20s right now, guys.
Live it up.
Love it. Love every fucking second of it.
Oh, my God. I was talking to Owen's. He has a niece who's, like, 17. And she had her phone up in this way. And I was like, are you taking a selfie? And she went, ew, no. And I stopped in front of her and in front of her mother. Yeah. And in front of one of Owen's other aunts. And I said, don't you ew know selfies, because one day you are going to be old and you are going to wish you took so many more photos of yourself when you were young and hot. Mm-hmm. So don't feel like you aren't allowed to enjoy the way you look, because it will be gone very quickly and you will feel very angry at yourself. And I said this and her mother immediately chimed in and was like, oh my God, I wish I had so many more photos of myself. I used to be so hot. And I was like, see?
Same.
Exactly. And she looked really taken aback. Like, I think her mother saying I used to be so hot really like freaked her out a little bit. And that's
funny. It's just true though.
Yeah. I mean, I understand people like worrying about the footprint that they leave on the internet because you can't take stuff back and you're wanting, you know, to get into a professional job one day, but you have too many ass photos on Instagram. But at the same time...
Is that a problem? Too many ass photos on Instagram?
Do you know how many booty accounts there are on Instagram?
I do not.
And I cannot imagine a lot of those women don't also have a day job. I'm sure they would love to not have a day job. And, you know, granted.
That's why they're doing the booty photos you on know? Instagram.
But, like, I'm sure that they do it under a different name, that they try and, like, keep that separate from a lot of the rest of their lives and so that employers can't make it searchable. And you know, I understand that that can be a risk, but at the same time, I have a hard time believing that you ever really regret doing things when at least you are allowed to maintain control of it. It's different when somebody like revenge porns you or something.
Oh yeah. That's a completely different thing. We're not talking about that right now, but yeah, like for things that you obviously consented to, man, do that shit.
Yep.
I mean, don't get yourself like, you know, charged with a felony.
Right.
But, yeah, I mean, listen, also, I think a weird thing that we have to fucking get back to the book.
Right, I know.
But when you hear these warnings, you know, from older generations to younger people about, oh, you know, be careful what you do on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
You are being talked to by people who don't know or have any idea what it's like to grow up in this age.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So... the people that are going to be your coworkers and probably even your first couple of like managers and supervisors, they're the same fucking people on TikTok with you right now.
Yep.
Like y'all are all going to just grow up and be in charge if we don't burn the whole fucking world down before that. So
yeah, you know my advice is if you are about to go into an interview and you even suspect that they have something to say about your Instagram or your TikTok, you find out who's about to interview you and you find their Instagram and TikTok.
That's what I'm talking about.
And you hold that shit up and be like, I'm sorry, you said what now? And they'll be like, nothing.
Exactly. Fucking exactly. All right.
Anyway.
So, okay.
So
wild digression.
Harry is talking about how he can hear them talking in this weird language and is hiding. And then is suddenly like, wait a minute. Hiding? Why the fuck am I hiding? They are the garbage murdering monsters who took my fucking kid.
Yep.
And then he quotes Tolkien. Do not meddle in the affairs of wizards, for they are subtle and quick to anger. Tolkien had that one mostly right. I stepped forward, let the door bang closed, and snarled, fuck subtle.
Yeah. This is 100% Harry Dresden needing to fuck some shit up.
Yep.
Because his world just got fucked up.
Yep.
I love that he says when he, you know, he hears the voice, he says that it whispered to him from within the storm in his chest.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's all those feelings, you know, mulling around inside.
Yeah. They're
like, hey, this looks like a great opportunity. To fucking, you know, blow some steam off.
Yep.
And then he does that and blows a bunch of holes in the doors, blows several vampires right in half, which, gruesome.
Yeah, it's pretty good stuff.
But it's, you know, and when this was all happening, because it's pretty good, you know, the action sequence. But I kept thinking, who's all in this fucking building? You know, like I was reading it and I was like, okay, so it's the middle of the night.
Mm-hmm.
Probably not like really anybody in there, but we didn't do a check.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Harry went up the stairs. He didn't check any floors. He just fucking went in and didn't think at all.
Yeah.
About what the fuck he was doing. And there's so much destruction happening that when there's gunfire, we don't know who it's coming from. Turns out to be Susan.
Right.
But, like, he wasn't really 100% thinking about where everybody was.
No.
He was just, I'm Harry Dresden and I make things go boom.
I think that's an excellent postcard. I think that's it for this month. I am Harry Dresden, and I make things go boom. I think he would really co-sign that if he heard it.
It feels like something he would say, right?
Yeah.
Sure, why not?
I know that there's a few fuck subtle t-shirts out there.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
That's pretty good. That is actually really good. So yeah, he's like fucking them up in a hallway. He's chasing them.
Yeah.
Like,
he's chasing them.
Like, and okay. So part of me is like, well, yeah, you got to chase them because you don't want to let them just get away. But then the other part of me is like, but this is not what we're here for, though.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they were coming to ambush, maybe. So if you disrupt the ambush and you send them running, maybe that's okay for now.
Maybe that's enough.
Right. For right now.
Right.
And he's like, no. He just... And they're trying to get, like, sensitive shit out of the office. And he's fucking... Sprinklers are going off. Shit is on fire. You know? Like, he really, really... This is... I feel like we haven't seen him be this reckless in a minute. And I guess it makes sense because... this level of, I don't know what to call it, but this stakes. Revelation. Yeah. I guess the stakes are very different than anything we've seen before. Mm-hmm. I mean, the closest we can come to, I think I said last week, was Harry's love for Thomas.
Right.
So I am concerned. This is super early, but I am really concerned if this is how Harry is going to be throughout this book, because his alleged child is in danger. Is it just going to be, I don't think clearly, I'm short-sighted and I just lose my shit every time? I just hope that's not, you know, what I have in store.
Guys, this is
I feel like you should be reassuring me. Why aren't you reassuring me now? I don't care for this at all.
Oh, God. I have not gotten a good cackle like this in a while. But anyway. So let's see. Oh, yeah. I remember. I forgot that he cuts one in half. He cuts another one. And then there's one hanging from the ceiling. Mm-hmm. He gets that one and then goes. It saw me around the corner and its goggling black eyes seemed to get even larger. It let out a scream of terror. It screamed in fear. And
that's right. You better run, pretty boy. This is what I'm talking about. This is the behavior that I cannot condone. This is not responsible behavior.
You thought calling him pretty boy was just a step too far?
A little bit. You know, I mean, like he's and I love it too, because the way it's written is he says, I heard myself scream,
mm-hmm.
which sort of implies a bit of like, he's not even in control of his actions right now.
Yeah.
Right? Like he's just like good sense Harry is just riding along as bad idea Harry. Just completely loses his shit all over the place.
That's fair.
Yeah, good sense Harry and bad idea Harry.
And he really starts to realize this as, like, the sprinklers go off.
Oh, my God.
Which, like, it, you know, mitigates his power a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
it's also going to call the cops over, and they're fucking still in here. And... You know, the cops, like, even if it weren't about, like, oh, we're going to get caught on the scene, the cops are not prepared to deal with... Was that a moth?
It was. I'm so sorry. You guys, I am so sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
Oh, my God, I hit my mic. I'm sorry, everybody.
I'm so sorry.
We are a professional pair tonight.
That motherfucker came out of nowhere.
tell Steve to send one of the cats in to take care of it. Oh my God. That's what cats are for.
These fucking raggedy ass cats are not holding up their end of the deal. You guys, unacceptable. I'm so sorry. It flew right at my face, though. What did I tell you? Right at my fucking face. Jeez, let me turn this light down, first of all.
Oh, yeah, that is probably.
I'm going to just sit my ass in the dark.
Oh, turn God.
This bitch right on down. All right. So, I can barely see my book now.
What I was saying was that the authorities are not going to show up prepared to fight supernatural vampire forces. They're going to show up prepared to deal with a fire.
Right.
Because it is a fire alarm.
Mm-hmm.
And this is just, or maybe a break-in, potentially, and that's about it.
They're definitely not going to be expecting what the fuck is waiting for them.
Yeah.
Here. Yeah.
So overall, this is really getting into a bad scene. I love that a pair of bullets came through the wall not 6 feet away, and one of them tugged hard at the hem of my jeans. Ack! I said.
Oh my God.
Fearless Ack. Master of the witty dialogue. That's me.
It's such a cartoonish noise, too, right?
Chocolate, chocolate, chocolate! Ack!
Oh, that's good.
So he comes across two vampires in front of the door to an office. One of them has been shot and is leaking blood all over. The other is crouching next to the door, trying to decide whether or not it should just go in. Or, you know, what it should do.
Mm-hmm.
My runner went by them, wailing in fear.
Oh my God, this thing running from Harry Dresden is so goddamn funny. I don't know why exactly, but just the picture of it. It's so fucking ridiculous. And plus, he gave us like a really good reminder of what the Red Court vampires look like when mm-hmm. they're not like in their flesh mask. And they're described as being like knock-kneed and like lanky and kind of like
flabby.
Heavy, yeah, flabby, heavy bellies and like these long arms with these hands that drag. So I'm watching this thing like lumber down the hall as fast as it can with like its arms flopping behind it. And Harry just chasing it like a complete insane person with his like rod up in the air.
I like to picture it as like we're watching a movie and the camera is already around the corner and you just hear something going, getting louder. And then it comes around the corner at the camera, like still yelling and its footsteps are getting louder and louder. And then Harry comes crashing into the frame, like hits the wall because he's running too fast.
Do you know that cartoon American Dad?
I know of it. I've never seen it.
Never seen it? I was going to say, these Red Court vampires, they sound like Roger to me. But you don't know who Roger looks like, so I'm going to send you a picture real quick.
Okay.
So, one gets away, right?
Right.
One goes out through the window.
And the other one pulls up the wounded comrade and uses him as a meat shield as Harry throws a volley of fire, I think, again.
Yep.
The final vampire whirled toward me, hesitating. The wall behind it suddenly exploded outward, and Martin, his skin livid with dark tattoos, came crashing through it. So... Martin, I love him. Harry has just intercepted an ambush. Granted, not cleanly. But all Martin can say is, God damn it, you left one get away. And then later on, when he's talking to Susan, he's like, what the hell was he thinking with throwing magic around when he knows that we're dealing with electronics? And Susan has to be like, dude, be because he didn't want us to die. I know that's crazy. But yeah.
And she even, she says, look, you know, they had us. If mm-hmm. Harry hadn't come in right now, they had us. They completely snuck up on us and we wouldn't have been able to take them.
Mm-hmm.
Which I was surprised because I thought that this sort of, I mean, I called it reckless, you know.
Right.
I thought it was going to really end up looking like he ruined it and overreacted for no good reason. So when Susan is like, no, he fucking just saved our ass, I was like, oh, all right, I guess I was wrong. Because I had felt pretty strongly about my take on it.
I mean, I think that Susan's defending him out of loyalty as well, because Martin doesn't, it says that like he just looks at her and he doesn't reply. So part of me is like, well, Martin did say, as they're going into the building, we were likely followed because we didn't make a clean getaway.
Mm-hmm.
So Martin seems to be like more willing to admit that they're being followed and watched than she is to begin with. And now she's like, well, they had us, you know. And I can't help but be like, I mean, they shouldn't have. Y'all knew that it was likely you were being followed.
Right.
So I wonder how, like, I feel like this Martin showed a great amount of grace in not being like, yeah, they had us. Like, I fucking said they were going to have us. Remember when I said that?
I see what you're saying.
You know?
Yeah, that makes sense, too. I mean, but, you know, it's weird because all the bickering on the way to the building wouldn't suggest to me that Martin had any kind of restraint at all.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe after years of working with Susan, he knows when to not push a thing, you know?
Yeah. So at this point, Harry goes up, or Susan goes up to Harry because he says there were, like, we only took care of four. There were six. And Susan's like, oh, yeah, there's always six. That's how they operate. And then they're like, we really need to get out of here. And Harry's like, well, why? You need to get your stuff, right? And they say, the building is wired. The explosives are on the fourth floor placed all around your office.
So, yeah. This is the thing, too, that I'm embarrassed to admit it, but it didn't occur to me, I don't think, in practical sense, what it meant to find out that the owners of his office building were Red Court vampires.
Mm.
Like, the pettiness of it, you're just like, oh, I can't believe he's been fucking paying rent to them, you know?
Right.
And they've been basically able to keep tabs on him. But I don't think I thought to myself, oh, they could just bomb the fuck out of his office if they wanted to. Like, I didn't think it that far through.
Mm-hmm.
Which turns out to have been my mistake. Because, yes, they placed bombs all around his office. Mm-hmm. And did not hesitate to take the whole fucking building down.
Yep.
Which, I don't know. Do you think they... I'm trying to think. We are saying, I think what we're agreeing on is that the vampire gets away. He goes, or it goes, and alerts whomever, and they decide to blow the building up.
Right.
Are they thinking that they're going to get Harry because he's still in the building, or are they trying to keep them from getting access to any other information, or what? Do we know?
I don't think we know.
Okay.
Questions. So, yeah. Oh, and I love when he hears that they've wired it. Those jerks, they told us they were cleaning out asbestos.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. And his last fucking... Listen, I had to read this sentence legit 5 times. We had made it to the next block when light flashed and a giant the size of the Sears building hauled off and swatted all of us with a pillow from his enormous bed.
I can understand that in this universe, that might have been literal.
I had to stop and reread it. Because my brain could not make sense of what was happening. And I kept thinking, is there a fucking giant in the story now? What?
Yep. I understand.
It's a pretty good turn of phrase, though. It's quite a vivid image.
I love, and like, there's another time when he's talking to Murphy, and she asks him, like, what the problem is, and he says something about fairies, and she gives him a look thinking that he's fucking with her, and then she's like, oh my god, you meant that literally.
Exactly, though. That's exactly my point. Like, you know, there's no rule in this universe that says it couldn't have been a giant the size of the Sears Tower.
Yep.
You know, that could happen at literally any moment in any of these books.
It's true.
But it turns out that he's just describing what it feels like to be that close to an explosion. And it's a pretty good description.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. So, and oh my God.
The rent line.
I was thinking of the garbage can.
Oh, no.
Susan and Martin landed in a roll, tumbling several times. By contrast, I crashed into a garbage can. It was, of course, full.
Oh, yeah, that's good, too.
Oh, God, I'm sorry. But, yeah, you were talking about the
last line when after the building, like, goes down, he's thinking about his office and all the stuff that's gone. He just says, damn it. And Susan's like, what? I mailed the check in this morning for the rent. Which is just, let's pour a little salt on all those open wounds, sir.
That is so good.
It is such a hairy thing to happen to.
Mm-hmm.
Especially considering, like, you know, he's always, like, strapped for cash. And he has to, like, scrounge up his rent, pay it, and then they blow his fucking building up and try to kill him.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
So this is when he starts to think about what he had done once he gets home. Which,
there's this cabbie.
I don't like it.
I know, right? Harry doesn't like it either. Because basically they managed to get out of there like just before the police, you know, cordon off a perimeter, as he puts it.
Mm-hmm.
And this cabbie is hearing on the news what happened, and Harry's watching him piece together that likely the people that he just gave a ride to are involved because he picked them up right near there a second ago. And Harry asks him if he has a family and tells the guy, you never saw me, you got it? And the guy agrees.
Mm-hmm.
But Harry feels, like, sick to his stomach over the whole thing.
Yeah. He tips the guy, you know, on top of the money that Martin had given for the ride itself and the tip.
Mm-hmm.
And so at first you're just like, oh, he's going to, like, you know, throw him a whatever, 50 or whatever, 20. And just be like, hey, thanks, you know, I was never here.
Right.
But he does this other thing on top of giving him the money.
Yep.
And it's just, you know... It's just what we would hope is an empty threat. But this cabbie doesn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the thing, too, when people say, oh, you know, I didn't really mean it. I wouldn't really do it. But the thing is, when you threaten someone, like, the whole point of it is to cause them, like, concern mm-hmm. and worry and fear.
Yeah.
Like, that is your goal. And that makes it a shitty goal. You know, whether or not you have any intention on following through with the threat. So this, I don't know. I didn't. And Harry feels gross about it, and he should. And he also says, you know what? It's not going to be enough to keep this guy from talking to the cops if the cops should find him to ask him questions.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe it'll keep him from, like, volunteering information.
Mm.
And it's weird because Harry has been at the scene of so very many crimes. So many. You know, so many disasters and fires and collapses and all kinds of destruction. And I don't recall him ever feeling like he needed to do something like this.
I don't know how many times he's been in direct contact with a potential witness like this, though.
And that's going to be my next question is, or not really a question, but my next point, which is usually in these stories, there aren't what you would call innocent bystanders.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, no, you know what? That's not really fair, because a lot of times there are. There's like, you know, when you think about the convention center and that book, and there's usually like an airport thing early on in the series. There are
Harry riding on a Tyrannosaurus Rex down the street.
That, you know, so the public, you know, TM,
mm-hmm.
is a part of the books. You know, there's always like a public that needs to be saved, you know, and has no idea how close they came to X, Y, and Z. But we don't get a lot of individuals. You know?
That's fair.
And they run out of the building and they go out the back to avoid the police and end up having to just get a cab.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I don't know. I just didn't care for it. And I don't know. It seems really out of character. And I don't know if this is supposed to be a signal, you know?
Hmm.
I might be reading way too much into it, but I don't know if this is signaling to me that I am about to watch Harry do things that I never would have thought I'd see him do.
Hmm.
Or, you know, behave in, you know what I mean? Like,
Yeah. No,
but it's still, it's so early, so I don't want to get, like, too bogged down in it. But I didn't like it.
That's fair. I think, too, there's, like, a lot of times where Harry, if he got, like, brought in over something, it would be extremely frustrating because he knows he isn't responsible and he knows that they will eventually figure that out. But things are pretty time sensitive right now. So, and this comes up with Karen later, like, mm-hmm. he just cannot afford to be questioned about all of this. They will hold him for too long. And I think that's part of it is like he's reacting to the panic of like this, the building that was bombed was his building and the bombs mm-hmm. were focused around his office.
Right.
And if this, like, it's bad enough that he is involved in any way that can be figured out that easily. But if they then find out that he was also running from the scene, that's it. They're not letting him out, no matter, you know, if it's clear that he was the target, he can tell them something about what happened. So they would continue to hold him. And I think that's part of why he's taking such a drastic measure here.
Hmm.
It's just this, like, I cannot afford this at all right now. And I know that I'm not going to hurt this guy, but I have to ensure as well as I can that they have no reason to take me in, or if they do, it's at least like it would be a temporary thing versus right. how it would be if they found out I was there.
Right. Okay.
But that's just my interpretation. And feel free, anybody else listening, to chime in if you like agree that it was sort of out of character, or, you know, well, y'all, what did you think about this? And yeah, like you said, Harry begins to think about like the other people who could have potentially been in the building, and that, you know, it's a lot of businesses that are only open during the day, but that there could have been janitors
yeah.
or even people who did decide to come in for something that they forgot or were mm-hmm. working late.
I mean, hell, somebody might have been having an affair.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know what people were doing after dark when the building is closed.
Yep. So let's see. I'd unintentionally poured soul fire into every blast I'd leveled at them, which was why I had the nifty silver white blasts of flame instead of the red orange of standard issue fire.
Mm-hmm. And it's why he's so fucked and tired now.
Mm-hmm.
Because he used way more than he probably needed to.
Yeah.
And we know how that works. And he starts to talk here about how careful he needs to be, because every time he uses soul fire, it is, as far as we understand, burning up, like, parts of his soul. It's that's what fuels it, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
And he could fuck around and just...
accidentally kill himself.
Yeah, he says accidentally kill himself. I mean, I guess it makes sense if your soul's gone, then you just, you know... do you just stop living or do you just live without a soul?
Mm-hmm. That's an interesting question, too.
You know, I mean, I don't think that they make it clear. Like, well, no, he says, I think he says something like no soul means no life or something, I think.
Yeah. No more life force means no more life.
Yeah.
I think is the way he phrases it.
Right. So if the soul is the life force, then yeah. But if it's something different, you know, if it is something more... spiritual and in a more traditional, like what you think of your soul is, then you could be alive and not have one. I mean, The Simpsons showed us that very clearly, as did several seasons of Supernatural.
Oh my God.
But The Simpsons showed us that, you know, you can't like get the automatic doors to open.
God forbid. So he cleans up a little bit, and Murph shows up with a look on her face, and we find out pretty quickly that she had thought somebody had finally killed Harry.
Yeah.
She came to his house thinking that he probably wasn't going to be here.
Yeah. He has this, he does this whole describing her in excruciating detail, you know, basically to let us know that she has just rolled out of bed, jumped in her car and flew to his apartment.
Yep.
And then she sees him and her whole manner relaxes.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a sweet because it's not really a long drawn out scene. You know, he answers the door. He sizes her up, understands what she thought, you know, and then she sees him and then she just says, do I smell coffee?
Yeah.
So this surprised me. He brings Murphy right up to speed with this kid thing.
So you thought he was going to keep a secret?
I thought this was going to be a little kept quiet, but it turns out he's just telling everybody. I assumed it had to be kept quiet because these types of plot points usually are like huge secrets, right? And so I just assumed he couldn't tell anybody. And then once I made that assumption, my next thought was, well, yeah, because the less people that know, the less danger his daughter is in, right? You don't want word getting out because then everybody will be fucking wanting to kidnap her. But it turns out he tells Murphy, brings her 100% up to speed, and she has the exact right reaction.
Please, elaborate.
Oh, we all know what she said. That bitch.
And I like that Harry immediately is like, that is not helpful right now, granted.
But later.
But still not right now. And she's like, okay.
There'll be a time for bitch calling later. Indeed. Don't you even worry. I have penciled it in.
Oh, bitch calling.
So he tells her about the heist, trying to get the disc and all the data and everything. And he doesn't know what they have. They're going to call him. And he wants to know if she can offer him some kind of cover from the police.
Right.
And she's just like, you know what? It's complicated. You know, I really don't know, but I'll do what I can.
And she asks him if he's going to call in the White Council. And he's like, I don't know that they're going to do anything. And she's like, oh, really? Like, you know, but when he goes back with, can you get me help from the CPD? She's like, ah, yeah, all right, fine. True.
Right. Yeah, when he says, I'm not sure what they'll do, she says, you know, she calls them heartless, gutless, spineless old men. Oh, no, pricks. Old pricks.
Yes.
And then she tells him, this is really sweet, that not only is she in this fight with him, which she doesn't even hesitate. Mm-hmm. She tells him, I want in, right? And she tells him that they're going to get his daughter back.
Yeah.
And it's really, really touching. And he's just like, yeah, damn right I'm going to get her back. And she's like, no, listen to me. We will.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, oh, fucking Karen Murphy. I love her.
She's the best.
She is.
Anybody listening to this show who doesn't like Karen Murphy should probably stop listening to this show because you don't deserve it.
Okay? I don't know how anybody doesn't like Karen. She's badass.
She is a ride or die bitch. It takes a minute to get there because the first couple books, she is like, but Harry deserves to be suspicioned.
Yes.
Suspected.
He deserves to be suspicioned.
You get it? I warned you that I was drunk. It's fine.
It's totally fine. I love when he's like, he calls her, he says, I need a good gun hand. And that makes me sad that I'm not that. Like, I kind of want to be that now. I want to be somebody's good gun hand. That shit's dope as fuck.
You know what, shit. Though? He's got Susan. So, like, you know, granted, you're never going to have too many.
Right.
But I guess, you know, Karen says you need perspective in this because you and Susan are both too close.
Yeah. And I love he's like, at first I wanted to be like kind of a bitch about it, mm-hmm. but then I realized she's 100% right. And that shit is growth. Thank you, Harry Dresden.
Yeah, I appreciate whenever he's just like, I was about to bite her head off. And then I was like, I'm an asshole. Oh, how many times have I experienced that?
This weird line, it's not weird, but he talks about how great Karen is and how like good she's been over the years and she can handle her shit and all that. Mm-hmm. And he says, I know she would keep me or keep anyone, and I'm thinking of Martin, from stabbing me in the back.
Oh, she'd keep anyone, by which I meant Martin, from stabbing me in the back. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I know Harry and Martin don't like each other.
Mm-hmm.
Susan doesn't seem like she suspects Martin of anything. Clearly, that's been her working partner for however many years. She's been gone, like 8 years or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But Harry definitely doesn't trust him.
Well, they had that, like, you know, Harry basically was like, oh, hey, I know that you used me as a playing card last time you were in town. And yeah, Martin's like, but, oh, yeah, totally I did.
But I feel, I guess I felt like Martin is on this mission with Susan to help her get her daughter back.
Mm.
So why would Harry be, well, you know, I guess Martin could have like more than one objective. Like he could be trying to get the daughter back and also dispatching Harry if he could, you know, two birds, one stone.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, okay, it probably makes sense to not trust Martin that much.
I mean, not even necessarily dispatching Harry, because Harry, like, hurting Harry wasn't the objective last time. It was just, I want to get so-and-so, and if Harry dies, oh well. Was pretty much how it went last time.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like, if there was a way... Ouch.
Is that a moth?
No, this time it was my hair, but I overreacted because of the moth. And I poked myself in the eyeball.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear. Okay.
This has not been a great night, guys.
This has been Moth Watch. We'll return to our regular scheduled programming.
Fuck, I'm sorry. Jesus Christ. But, yeah, so Martin. I understand that his... his problem is not necessarily personal with Harry.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he doesn't really give a fuck about Harry either way.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So if there was a way they could rescue the daughter and say, also get rid of the Duchess.
Mm-hmm.
And if Harry just happened to be in the way, then Martin would absolutely not give a fuck.
Right.
And I imagine Susan probably would not be on board with that plan. So it would be Martin acting alone.
Yeah.
Right? So it would be Martin acting alone. So, okay, yeah. It's good to have somebody keeping an eye. But Harry calls it stabbing him in the back, which implies that Harry would take it as like a double cross and personal. Even though for Martin, it would just be like, you was just in the way.
I think that Harry, because Harry is like playing this like, well, Martin is allegedly here to help us get our daughter back. And I think Harry's like, what if he does not care about my daughter? And he winds up sacrificing, and not even like in terms of like Harry dying, but like, what if he winds up sacrificing our plan because he sees a better opportunity to do something else and doesn't actually follow through with getting Maggie back?
Well, see, that becomes a question for us and Susan, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, so Martin already showed us, I guess, when we met him last time, what he values, what his priorities are. And if someone gets in the way, he doesn't give a fuck. He's about accomplishing his mission, and he will use people to do that. It doesn't matter. And I can't remember how Susan ended up with Martin.
As a partner?
Yeah.
I don't know if they were assigned to each other or
it
how
felt
that
very much like she had run off and then she found this like rebel base mm-hmm. alliance or whatever.
The Fellowship of St. Giles.
And I think base. That was he was what?
I'm just making fun of you saying the rebel base.
Oh.
Go ahead.
So maybe he was just sort of like, you know, oh, you're a newcomer, we're gonna pair you up with this guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know. But to think that Susan could have been working with someone for 8 years and enlist him to help her save her daughter, and then that person double-crossing them because of an opportunity to achieve a particular aim presented itself.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the kind of people that Susan is running with now? See, the thing, I don't know anything really about. I don't know. That's too much. I have too many questions.
I think that's kind of where Harry's at, is like, he doesn't know for sure. He knows that Martin was capable of that once. And I think he's just kind of hoping that was because Martin had a goal that had nothing to do with his loyalty to Susan or the Fellowship. That mm-hmm. like it or it did have a it
for
was
the
involved with the Fellowship, but yeah,
but not mm-hmm.
so like maybe Harry's like, I'm hoping that his personal loyalty to Susan will be enough, but I can't like really
can't
guarantee
count on
that.
It.
Yeah,
yeah. I'm curious if we'll get a conversation. I feel like we'll have to have more conversations with Harry and Susan. Right? Like, they're going to have to talk a bunch more. I'm wondering if he'll bring up his concerns to Martin, or if he'll just won't even bother. And if he does bring him up, what Susan's response would be. Would she vouch for him, or would she... I don't know. I'm curious now. Because Susan might say, yeah, you know what? I've been working with Martin for 8 years. He is dedicated. He's like Morgan up in this bitch. You know, he's on that level of being dedicated to his calling and his cause and does not really have a lot of shades of gray. And I know that about him. So I know to only expect, you know, so much. You mm-hmm, know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Or I know that given a particular set of choices, I know what choice he would make. So I'm going to try to prevent that choice from having to be made.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know. I hope that we get a little bit more of that.
Okay, so... oh, right. This is when we will get her back. She said very quietly, we will, Harry. I'm in. So then, chapter 6. Harry... sleeps for a little while. And this is when we get like the, you know, background on Soulfire on instinct mm-hmm. is a mistake. I don't know if it made my spells any more effective, though I had a hunch that it sure as H-E double hockey sticks did. but I was dead certain that it had drawn upon my own life energy to do it.
Mm-hmm.
No more now life energy kind of means no more life.
Mm-hmm. Now it's all sluggish, can't stand up straight.
Mm-hmm.
Over a couple of Red Court vampires.
Yeah.
Sir.
I'm going to need you to rein it in.
I'm saying.
So then he talks about like emotion and that being a really good source of energy for spells. But that the danger is that you don't know how it's going to change the spell.
Oh, I love this.
Guys operating on my level can kill others or themselves at the slightest mistake. And then he thinks about the soul fire and emotions maybe being a little bit like mixed together and all of like, you know, there's a lot of potential here. And it's interesting every time we have Harry theorizing on stuff to be reminded how little he really knows in the end about everything. Less than 60 seconds of action the night before had left me exhausted. If I didn't get a handle on the soul fire, I could literally kill myself with it.
Mm-hmm.
So he goes out into the main room, and Molly is here making breakfast because they made a deal that if she made breakfast all week, he would give up coffee.
This is a ridiculous deal.
This is one of those things that's like, so Harry knows she can't cook.
Mm-hmm.
I have a hard time believing he would ever have agreed to this because he knows she can't cook.
This, I don't understand what's happening here. In what world can you not have coffee with your breakfast? In what world do you have to make a choice between the two? And why can't he have coffee in the morning? What is happening?
Oh my God, guys.
It makes no sense.
I love that this is probably the first time in these books about magic that you have ever said it makes no sense. And it's about not having coffee.
But no, not really though. What?
Listen, you know that I don't drink coffee. I have.
Go ahead. If you are not a coffee drinker, that is fine.
But this is what I'm saying is I do not drink coffee because as a kid, I watched my mother go through a horrific caffeine storm when she was without coffee for like 2 days in a row. And I realized that caffeine makes you super dependent, and I really didn't want to have anything to do with that. Now, granted, I did not think about soda. I never really was a big soda drinker, and I drink tea now. But that was my brain at the time.
Oh, okay.
When I was like deciding, because most people start to drink coffee as teens. You know, that's sort of when it happens. It's like a social thing because coffee bars are like the only place you can go that feels like a bar at all. You can have coffee. You can go to Dunkin' Donuts at 2 a.m. They're open kind of thing.
Oh, I didn't start drinking coffee until I was 19.
Oh, you're adorable. but caffeine is not good for you. Coffee is very acidic. It's not great for your gut. And usually people load it with sugar and cream, which are also not great for you. So that's the problem for her is that she's trying to get Harry to like, you know, rely on a more sustainable source of energy with food instead of depending on caffeine to wake up because, you know, it's probably like smart if Harry doesn't have to have coffee to function because he might be in situations where he can't get it.
I don't allow any of that. I disallow it.
I mean, I know I have spent weekends with you and I prioritized making sure that you had coffee available of one sort or another because I did not want to encounter you without it.
Nobody wants to see that.
I will say, though, that Jim Butcher betrays himself a little here as maybe not knowing a ton about nutrition because Harry's replacement for his coffee is orange juice, Which anybody who does know anything about nutrition knows that juice is pure sugar and is no better for you than a cup of coffee. Like, mm-hmm. not really. It's got more vitamins in it, allegedly. But it's not really good for you either. It's just a spike of your... It's something that you give diabetics when their blood sugar's low because it causes an insulin spike.
She made bacon and eggs and toast.
Turkey bacon.
Okay, that's right. You're right. It was turkey bacon. Yeah. I forgot about that. Okay. All right.
Yeah. Yeah.
I still don't think it's fair. I don't think you can have a man, you know, tasked with what he has to face and have him start his day with orange juice.
I feel like Harry basically feels this way. Like, I think Harry's like, if you knew what was going on with me right now, you would not be putting me through this. And one could argue that is the only reason that he is honest with Molly about what's going on. It's so because he's trying to get his fucking coffee out of her.
Yeah, because surprise, surprise, he ends up telling Molly everything too.
Mm-hmm.
Brings her right the fuck up to speed. And, you know, she also has a really good response. Like, she says, how can I help?
Mm-hmm.
Which I love when people say that.
Yeah.
and he thinks about, you know, her abilities and, you know, she's not really combat material, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But he talks about having learned that you can withhold information is a way to go.
Right.
You know, sometimes you can tell a whole truth. That's the way to go, too. And from experience, he has decided that the best thing to do is just tell her. Just tell her everything.
Yep.
And I feel like in a different story, a different writer maybe, a different character, this information of Harry having a kid doesn't get out this early in any other book, you know? It just really feels counter to everything that I expect from these types of stories, you know?
Yeah.
That's like midway through, finally you have to break down and share your secret with one person so they know what you've been going through. But I like this because it feels like Harry's getting a team together.
Yeah, I think that the idea of, like, now I have to finally break down and tell you my secret is Butcher's first four books. You know, and he's just, like, kind of done with Harry not trusting people at this point. Well, other than Martin, I guess.
Right.
And has decided that he is going to try. And he has a really mature... because when she says, how can I help? He reflects on his ignorance is safety, like, method of behaving that he had employed for so long.
Mm-hmm.
And he realizes that people can die from, you know, having enough information and choosing to do a thing because they are still not prepared. They can die from not having enough information because you didn't let them know what the real risks are. There's all kinds of ways that shit can go wrong. And he has to recognize that what it comes down to is other people have to make the choice for themselves, because without information at all, he will definitely feel guilty about it.
Mm-hmm.
But if they have the information and they chose to do a thing, despite knowing the risks to a degree, that is not his fault. They made a choice as an adult. And
right.
So I liked that he kind of just is like, because I had no way to know what would happen, I'd come to the conclusion that absent factors that might make me believe to the contrary, I just wasn't wise enough to deny them the choice.
Yeah, I like that a lot, too. Sorry, I lost my train of thought. Fuck. What's I getting ready to say? That it's gone.
All right. Like a moth out the window. So the only responsible thing to do was let her decide for herself how she wanted to live her life. That included endangering it if that was what she felt was appropriate. So much as I had for Murphy, I laid it out for the grasshopper. And she says they need more information. We have to go to Edinburgh. And they do.
They do. They just, they hop on the way,
mm-hmm.
get there easy peasy. And there's all kinds of, I love that this place is like so huge. Molly's just like, what the fuck? Like, how fucking big is this place? And he's like, actually, it's about the size of the city. There's shit you haven't even seen yet.
Yeah.
And they take this long walk and he tells her a little bit about the history of the place. Not much, but that it's, you know, that the rumor is that the whole place used to belong to, like, the actual Merlin, like the Merlin.
Yeah.
And that's a pretty cool little fun bit there.
Yeah, I like that too. He must have been something else. He must have been a real bastard, I said. Guys who get their names splashed all over history and folklore don't tend to be Boy Scout troop leaders.
Facts.
Hashtag facts.
Yep.
Have no heroes. It's fine.
So they go through a couple checkpoints and everything seems fine, but then they get into like where all the wardens are supposed to be and like no one is around.
Mm-hmm.
And, Harry uses the word buggery and Molly does not let it go by unnoted. I really appreciate that.
Buggery?
And there's this woman. And I couldn't tell at first, but she's some kind of switchboard operator, turns out.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't recognize it because it is not 1932 anymore.
Right, and so this is not John Wick. Evidently, it kind of is, I guess.
It kind of is. So
Harry's John Wick, except instead of a dog, it's his daughter.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Jesus Christ. So she is straight up ignoring them because she's soups busy. And finally, she's like connecting all these calls and she sounds really pissed off and irritated. And she's saying the same thing over and over again. And she's so tired of it. And I 100% understand that feeling. And finally, Harry is just like, hello? Hello?
Mm-hmm.
And she tells them, first of all, she cannot believe they don't know. And yeah. I think it's a little weird. I mean, Harry's been busy. And I guess communication from Edinburgh to Chicago must not be that important. Because no one told Harry about what was happening. Mm-hmm. And I'm not really sure where he's supposed to go to get his warden information. You know, I don't
That's
know
That's a good question,
to,
actually.
Yeah, like, I don't
Is
know
there if there a newsletter?
Right? Is there, like, I mean, it can't be fucking online. So... I mean, does he have to call in like once a day just to see if there's anything on the itinerary for that day or, yeah, I don't know. None of that's been discussed. So, so he doesn't know that Duchess, Ortega is like here.
Right.
Or on her way. I don't know if she's here yet or she's on her way, but she's coming under the guise of proffering like a real lasting peace,
right?
Which I don't think any of us are falling for, right? 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 So yeah. So I mean, I feel like this is where the chapter ends.
Yeah,
him finding out that she's like on site. So. Remember how I was talking about, like, bad idea Harry and good sense Harry?
Yeah,
so, I do. Bad idea Harry hears that she's here and completely goes apeshit.
What does going apeshit look like?
He bursts into whatever room they're all having their very formal meeting, you know,
mm-hmm.
and starts screaming, demanding the release of his child, threatening to bring the whole place down if she doesn't. and nobody else knows what he's talking about, and he has to be restrained by wizards, you know. That feels like it would be a terrible mistake. And I have to say that even though in my heart I feel like Harry could be pushed to do that, my head is saying, no, he would never. That is just too dumb. He would never. So what are his other alternatives?
So when you say it would be a huge mistake, why would it be a mistake?
To just attack her like that in front of everybody?
Oh, you didn't say attack. You said makes demands and has to be restrained.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Oh, he goes in to like threaten to kill her if she doesn't immediately, you know.
Gotcha. Okay.
You know, baby probably already has his staff raised, aimed at her. You know what I mean?
Gotcha. Mm-hmm.
It goes in like that. But that just feels like too much, you know. Because it's so early in the book. If he were to do something, that would just blow everything up. I mean, he would force... Because I don't know all the rules, but I know... I feel like it's been established that there are certain... what do you call it? Like...
procedures.
Procedures and an etiquette, you know? Mm-hmm. So, like, when someone comes to you to talk about peace, there's, like, there has to be some kind of, like, agreement, right? Like, some kind of accord to be, like, as long as you're here on this business, you have our protection, or we won't raise a hand against you, or, you know, whatever. Like the deal at Max, where you can't, like, fight there.
Right. Okay, I got
you. So some kind of something that makes it safer for her to be there to talk about this piece. Mm-hmm. So then if Harry just comes flying in, blowing shit up, he's broken, you know, whatever rules of hospitality may exist. And now look what he did.
Mm.
So all that to say is I don't think Harry does anything that extreme, but I think he might have to fight not to do it, you know, like maybe he'll find out she's there and those feelings like similar to what he had in the office building, but magnify because it's her, you know, right. Those were just unnamed fucking flunkies. Like this is her.
Mm-hmm.
It would be that kind of rage magnified by 100.
Yeah, it makes sense. So
he would need a very stern, calming something. Because I'm just thinking, I don't know where he's going to get it from, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because I just thought for a second, I imagine, like, Ebenezer coming out and, like, calming him down before he could start anything. But Ebenezer doesn't know. So, you know, there's no reason to come and intercept Harry.
I mean,
I don't know.
But everybody is at this meeting, so Ebenezer could just be there.
Yeah. So, but I meant like get to Harry before he even has a chance to look like a threat to anyone.
Oh, got you. Okay.
And since Ebenezer doesn't know about the kid, there's no reason for him to be like, you know,
yeah,
making sure Harry's not going to lose his shit.
Mm-hmm.
It's possible that Harry opens the door and Ebenezer takes one fucking look at his face and is like, oh, I know that face. You know? But yeah. Maybe he bumps into somebody in the hallway before he gets to the room where she's at.
Hmm.
Maybe Molly is able to talk him down. I mean, that's a big, tall order for her. But maybe. I don't know.
I am really delighted at how much you're making predictions here.
Oh, I didn't mean to do all that.
No, it's just like, it's because oftentimes I'll ask if you have predictions and you just kind of go, nope. And it's fun to listen to you. Like, really, you went in on some long theories here and I like it. It's a good time to listen to that. That's what I'm here for, baby. So, yeah, so that is the end of the chapter. So I guess we'll see what happens next week. Let me double check. 'Cause I remember that I said at one point that, there was a chapter that was like way shorter than the others that I knew we were going to cover as a, what do you call it? As part, like we would change it to four chapters that particular week. But I don't think that's coming up quite yet. Why can't I? I'm trying to look at it in Audible without actually starting playing the book. Oh, good.
I felt my stomach flutter around inside me.
Holy shit.
That shit is impactful. He just has a real voice, man. He really does.
That's funny.
Chapter 7, 8, and 9 are normal length. We're good for that. Next week after that, we're good as well. It won't be until like 3 weeks from now. It's chapter 16 that's super duper short. So we'll probably be doing 16, 17, 18, 19 that week. But that's a little whiles away. So
okay.
All right, cool. I wanted to let everybody know that Miles and I have finally wrapped on Twilight, and we are going to be starting Mistborn recordings next week. So if you're interested in listening to me be unspoiled for once, and me be unspoiled for something that a lot of people love, which is the Mistborn series by Brando Sando, which is what we are now calling Brandon Sanderson, I believe is his full name. Somebody called him Brando Sando in the Crowdcast, and I have latched onto that. It just really feels right to me. So if anybody feels like listening to that, you can become a patron at patreon.com/unspoiled, and it's at the $5 level, which is the lowest level. And it is going to be a weekly podcast. And Miles is very spoiled, has read all of the Mistborn books, not just the trilogy, although we are going to be starting with just reading the trilogy. And I am pretty excited about it because we definitely want to be reading something good after finishing Twilight.
Ah, that's true.
And also, we are at 93% on the fundraiser. So RoShawn and I have this going until after we are done recording the third season of Westworld. And, you know, being at 93% before we've started recording, we're in pretty good shape. I'm feeling positive about this. I'm hoping that we'll reach it. So I just wanted to give you guys all a reminder that if you are interested in RoShawn and I covering A Song of Ice and Fire, on a slightly different format than what we have done in the past, which is normally there's one person who's totally unspoiled and it won't quite be that way. You guys can come and become a patron and help us boost our way up, because that's how this fundraiser is working, is we're trying to get to a goal on Patreon. And it will still be a free show that is available on iTunes. So those of you who are like, oh, I really want them to do that, but I can't afford to become a patron, you can share information about the show any place that, you know, you talk about this sort of thing and encourage other people to become patrons. And I think a lot of people don't quite realize how much of an impact that can make, because like you leave a comment that's like, you should check out Unspoiled, and if like, you know, only five people like it, you're like, oh, whatever. But there might be a lot of people who didn't like your comment and are still clicking the link that you left, you know. So, you know, if you are not able to become a patron, I totally get that, but there are other ways to support the show and try and ensure that other people become patrons. And I have had a fair number of people recently, you know, I was really having a big surge when we were doing Harry Potter. And I was extremely worried that when I was done with Harry Potter, that I would see a drop in pledges. That has not happened at all, which is amazing.
Yeah, and that's really good.
Right. And, I've had a few people recently that signed up, and there's a questionnaire, when you join the Mighty Network, or just a single question of me being like, why did you become a patron? And I have seen a couple people be like, well, I just really enjoy the Dresden Files. Then I started listening to other stuff. So this has become the show that's drawing people now.
Oh,
when it had been okay. Harry Potter. So that's pretty cool. So yeah, anyway, if you are interested again, it's patreon.com/unspoiled. And, also for the $10 and up level, you get a postcard. So I guess this one's going to be, what was it that you said? Harry. What are you giggling about?
Because I knew we wouldn't remember it.
I'm so bad at this. You said something like Harry Dresden blows shit up, or Harry Dresden's good at blowing. I don't know.
Harry Dresden's good at blowing. And I make things go boom.
I think that is what it was. Thank you. So yeah, you'll get a postcard like that if you're a $10 patron. A postcard of a quote that I definitely remember 100%. And if you're $20 and up, you can listen to me and RoShawn talk about Animal Crossing, which we just started talking about last week before she had a Switch, which she now has.
This game, you guys.
I'm so excited about it. I need to get her hooked. So yeah, that's the $20 and up is Unsober, which is a twice a month recording where we just choose a random subject and just talk about that for like an hour and a half, 2 hours.
And you guys get to come and join us in the chat on the Crowdcast.
Yep.
And hang out with us.
Hang out with us, talk to each other, try not to distract RoShawn because she is not good at focusing on the chat and on me. And I love, somebody made a meme of the woman, like, you know, talking to the other and the one shrinking back away from her into the couch. And the one that's talking at her was labeled Natasha talking about thoughts and feelings with great sincerity. And the woman shrinking away from her was RoShawn focusing on the chat. And it was one of the most, like, perfect things. It was so accurate. I will be out here pouring my soul out. And then I see her eyes are not focused on me. She is not reacting to words. And I'm like, oh, I lost her. Where'd she go? RoShawn, come back. She'll start typing. I'm fucking thinking I don't see her. She's on camera. Anyway.
I get overstimulated.
So, yeah. And if you are a $20 and up patron, you can, like, you know, give us ideas for Unsober episodes as well. Because people ask us to cover certain things. And that was where we got the ideas for, like, episodes on language, episodes on, like, sexual experiences, which was a real funny one. And then, you know, I'll pick something at random at times, like outer space.
That was such a good one.
That was a fun one, right? I like that one. I think we all learned a lot. We learned more than most of us ever wanted to know.
Oh, space is terrifying.
And they poop in bags.
Oh, my God.
All right. Well, I think that's about it. I think I've sold it.
Just leave the bags up there.
So thanks for listening, everybody. We love you. And we will see you next week with three more chapters. Until then, toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.